looking for their first base runner of the night. Scott Schoenweiss has retired the first six men he has faced on just 16 pitches. Mason Veritek, the hitter, takes the first one for a strike. It's Veritek, Brian Daubach, and Darren Lewis. Veritek at 259, 8 home runs, 56 driven in. Quickly down on the count, 0-2. Schoenweiss wasting nothing. Veritek went 1-for-3 last night against the Rangers. Goes with his pitch, gets it past Mulvaughn for the first hit of the night for the Red Sox.
Well, good piece of hitting there by Jason Veritek. You're down a couple of strikes. You got to protect the whole plate. Schoenweiss trying to work him away, and he'll just take what he's going to give him. Shoot the ground ball past the dive of Mo Vaughn.
The first base.
Veritek, who had one hit last night, 1-for-3, picks up the first hit of the night to read the ball club.
And that brings up Brian Daubach, who was batting eighth tonight and playing first base. His next hit will be his 100th on the season. Squares as if to bunt. He's batting eighth. Figures that's what a number eight hitter does. 252, 16 home runs, 61 RBI. He hasn't hit this far down in the order very often, Jerry.
Well, he hasn't played very much recently either with all the lefties pitching and get some of those right-handers up the top of the order. Daubach hitting in that eighth spot tonight. He might have been bunting on his own because count went to 0-1, then he swung away.
Little chopper to third. Goss has it. And he moves the runner along. He tired on the play, but Jason Veritek moves into scoring position at second.
Now, the way both of these guys have started the game, one run could be a lot. Staying away from the strikeout, making contact, and when that happens, something good might happen, and this time he gets the man to second base. Nice play by Troy Glass, as he'll get Daubach at first, but the Red Sox get a man in scoring position. Battle those lefties with two strikes. Make contact.
And here's the number nine hitter, Darren Lewis. He's batting 245. He has two home runs and 12 RBI. Trot Nixon with the night off. The lefty on the hill.
One thing they tell us about Schoenweiss, he is not afraid to come inside on those right-handers. He'll throw that sinker down and away, but then he'll also throw that cross-seam fastball in on the right-handers. Nixon and Lansing both with time off tonight, at least the start of the game.
Again in tight. Nixon also had the night off last night.
Score the first run of the game. Darren Lewis on his way to second. He has a double, and the Red Sox have a 1-0 lead.
Well, after a couple of pitches inside, Lewis may be thinking that way, and then he gets something out over the plate and just drilled it right down that third base line. Now, Lewis almost always an up-the-middle opposite field hitter, but this time he got a pitch he could pull, gets it by Glass, and puts the Red Sox on top 1-0. RBI number 13 on the season for Darren Lewis, and he's been hot. Three hits last night, now the double to drive in Veritek.
And back to the top of the order we go. It's Jose Offerman, who grounded to short his first time up. has been red hot going into this game tonight. He's 7-for-19 on the homestand. Just does whatever Jimmy Williams asks him to do. One out, one run home. We're in the bottom of the third. The Red Sox lead it 1-0. The 0-2 gets away, and Lewis will move to third.
Two times now he's got ahead of those right-handers. He's trying to throw that hard slider down and in. This time it'll get by Benji Molina. Deflect right off the glove and back to the backstop. Now Lewis at third base with less than two outs. Would have been nice if that would have happened maybe a couple of pitches early, give Offerman something to work with. He's down to the two strikes now, but they do have Lewis at third, and the Angels are going to pull that infield in.
Kind of early in the ball game, but like you said, Jerry, Rolando Arojo is pitching very well in the early going. And that one is going to be back through the middle for a base hit, and Lewis comes in to score. Well, the Red Sox take advantage of the Angels playing the infield in.
See, had there been nobody out in that inning, they may not have come in with the one out, less of a chance of a big inning. They pull the infield in, and Offerman right to the left of Kevin Stocker in that dive. So the wild pitch becomes pretty big.
And here's Lou Maloney, swung at the first pitch his first time up, flew out to center. How about that? Over the last 11 days, Lou Maloney, the best in the American League. I bet he didn't think that was going to happen as he was on the plane ride home from Japan.
I bet he's got more fans here at Fenway Park than he had in Japan.
But the good thing is he didn't understand it when they were yelling at him in Japan. Schoenweiss a little unraveled here in the third inning. 3-0 to Lou Maloney. Carl Everett waits on deck. Taking all the way, it's 3-1.
See if they send Offerman on the 3-1 count. Schoenweiss got quite a few ground balls. You want to try to stay away from that double play. He doesn't go 3-1. I'm quite sure he'll be going 3-2 if it gets to that point.
Mo playing in front of the runner at first base. Offerman staying put, but he can walk down to second as Lou Maloney draws the walk.
Visit from Bud Black, the Angel pitching coach. Big series for the Angels and Mike Socia, obviously trailing the Red Sox by a couple of games in the wild card race. They had a nice weekend against the Yankees. Now they come to Boston and try to make up some ground here.
Bud Black wondering what's gone wrong here in the third inning. Through the first two innings, Schoenweiss needed just 16 pitches to retire the Red Sox. He's thrown 20 in this inning alone and still
number
only
two,
one out.
The center fielder, Carl Everett.
Two runs home here in the third. The Red Sox have runners on first and second with one out for Carl Everett. 0-for-1 tonight. At the first pitch. couple of guys breaking some RBI droughts. Darren Lewis is first since August 4th, and Jose Offerman is first since July 18th. Of course, he's been on the disabled list, too. Red Sox looking for more.
Next home run for Everett will be number 30, and he'll be the first Red Sox outfielder to have 30 home runs since Tony Armas hit 43 home runs back in 1984. That's hard to believe. That's
wow.
Yeah.
And they're going to call a ball. On the showing us.
Well, they were faking toward second base. The infielders were trying to keep Offerman close. There must have been some kind of movement before he stepped off the rubber. Let's take another look. Look back to second base.
May have been a little lean just before he stepped back, but well, very subtle. Very subtle.
Even speeding that thing up, it wouldn't have looked like much of a move.
The Angels at this point now will trade the run for the out. Offerman the runner at third. Lou Maloney the runner at second. Everett needs to get it in play. Down in the count 1-2. Grounds it to third. Loss will look the runner back. And Everett gets it into play, but that's the one guy you don't want it to be hit to.
And they probably won't face Nomar here with first base open. I'm sure they'll walk in and take their shot with O'Leary. The one big high hop to Troy Glass. He'll check the runner at third base and across the diamond to get Everett. Nomar will get the intentional walk. That'll be the 15th of the season. He'll trail Frank Thomas by one.
Fans at Fenway don't like it. O'Leary was a strikeout victim his first time up against Schoenwitz.
Even if there was a right-hander hitting behind Garcia Parra, they would still intentionally walk him. He's the guy they go over to the meeting and say, we're not going to let him beat us. So anytime first base is open in this kind of situation, they'll take their chances with the next guy, regardless of who it is.
And they're loaded up for Troy O'Leary. Red Sox trying to turn this into a big inning. Two runs home. The inning started with a Jason Varitek base hit. He went to second on Brian Dalbach's ground out. Scored on Darren Lewis's double down the line and left. Jose Offerman plated him. Maloney walked. Everett grounded out. Nomar has been intentionally walked, and that brings up Troy O'Leary. Tired on three pitches his first time up. Seems like Schoenwitz would be particularly tough on the lefties as he kind of comes three quarter at you. Back up the middle and handled by Adam Kennedy over to Kevin Stocker for the final out of the inning. So the Red Sox will leave them loaded, but they do score two. And after three complete, the Red Sox lead it 2-0.
Ashbraham, is that, they got a lot of private schools out in that area. Very expensive.
thought Paul Carroll, he needs to sneak me the answers for the first four or five games just to make people think I know what I'm talking about.
He'll sneak you the wrong ones. He gets a kick out of stumping everybody. Because he basically has no life.
No argument there. Kevin Stalker, the shortstop, is up. The number two hitter was a strikeout victim back in the first. Stalker, Mo Vaughn, and Tim Salmon here in the fourth against Rolando Araujo. Continuing to work ahead, it's 1-2. Ground ball through into right field for a base hit. First one of the night for the Angels. Here's Mo Vaughn with a runner on. Those are the numbers with the Angels. 63 home runs, 203 RBI. That one deep to left. Troy O'Leary with a little deke. It's off the wall. Sends it into second base. He'll hold Mo to the single, but on the play, Kevin Stalker, who was not fooled one bit, moves into third.
Now, those are the kind of hits that are going to make Mo really miss Fenway Park. Mo, of course, just about any time he wants with that inside-out swing, can plant one off that left field wall. The deke by O'Leary just made Stalker hesitate for a second, but he was not going to be able to score anyway. High off the wall, O'Leary will get it back in the second and try to keep that double play in order. But a couple of hits and some trouble here for the Red Sox.
The first bit of trouble of the night for Araujo, who had allowed just one base runner through the first three innings. Facing Tim Salmon now. Not Salmon on strikes. First time up. And he has not fared well in eight career at-bats against the Red Sox righty. The Red Sox looking for the double play up the middle. And that one's through into left field for a base hit. Three consecutive hits for the Angels, and they're on the board. It's 2-1.
Now, second time through this Angel lineup, a little bit more difficult for Araujo. Salmon with the base hit, his first hit ever off Araujo. He's now 1-for-9 in his career, and he picks up his 74th RBI of the season with this base hit.
And quickly, pitching coach Joe Kerrigan wants to come out to have a word with his right-hander. See Mike Socia, the Angels manager, Mo Vaughn, talking to him before the ball game. He was saying that that's been the biggest difference on this team this year, playing for Mike Socia.
Number 16, the center fielder, Garrett Anderson.
Says he's tough, but also fun. So good combination if you can be tough and fun. Here's Garrett Anderson, who has grounded into 17 double plays, the most on the Angels. That would look good right about now.
Bruno trying to sink that fastball down and away to try to induce the ground ball. Now in trouble though at the 2-0 count.
Still nobody out here in the fourth inning. Him up. Maloney is there, and he has it for the first out of the inning.
Well, it looked like Anderson a little over anxious on that 2-0 count. He got a fastball, but it appeared to be a little bit high in the zone. He'll get underneath this fastball, pop it up, and a big out for Rojo.
Troy Gloss.
You take that down about another 4 or 5 inches, and that's one that he can drive a long way, but not that one. He'll pop it up, and the Red Sox get their first out here in the fourth.
And it's a dangerous order when you realize Troy Gloss bats all the way down to the number six spot. So still a very tough hitter for Rojo to face here with one out. How many of the rotisserie nuts picked Troy Gloss to be among the league leaders in home runs? I'll tell you what, that's a position right now in baseball that's kind of light on superstars or big hitters.
Now this guy is just going to continue to get better and better. What a tremendous talent. You could see it when he was first called up to the big leagues. And he improves it just about every game.
Shoots that back into the stands, and it's 1-2.
He does strike out a lot, 126 strikeouts on the season. And that's second to his teammate, Mo Vaughn.
His team does strike out an awful lot. But they hit a lot of home runs too. They make up for it. They have, as a team now, they have 799 strikeouts. Number 800 would look pretty good. Only four teams with more strikeouts than the Anaheim Angels. Oakland leads the way with 892. It's interesting, similar teams. Both teams hit a lot of home runs. Both teams strike out a lot. Full count, and he lost him. Loss lays off the pitch inside, and the bases are loaded for Benji Molina.
Number one, the catcher, Benji Molina.
Molina grounded to short his last time up. Career with the bases loaded, 333. He has one career grand slam. Him into short center. On comes Carl Everett, and that one is going to drop in there safely. The Red Sox may have a play at third, and where's the call? A hesitant call here by the second base umpire, and there's going to be an argument here. Mike Socha is out there quickly. Second base umpire Darryl Cousins really hesitated. Don't know if he knew it was his call or not, as third base umpire Jerry Meals was down the line. I never knew Mike Socha could run that fast.
He flew out of that dugout. The third base umpire went out to check the play out in center field, and it was Cousins who was hanging around the middle of the infield, and I'm not even sure Cousins was looking at the play at third base.
And he didn't sell it very well either, Jerry.
Well, they waited a long time to make the call. There was a lot of indecision on this play. Chris, we'll see Everett almost make an outstanding catch. He'll go into the slide. See, he's the only guy, if he catches it, is going to be able to throw somebody out. With those infielders going in that direction, they probably wouldn't get anybody at home play. Now, here's the throw from Offerman. This becomes a force play. Oh, wow.
Never even had the bag.
Maloney was not even in contact with the bag. That's a horrible call.
Well, when Mike Socha sees that, he is going to be very angry. I'm not sure if Lou Maloney was thinking this was a force play.
He was never on the bag. It's almost like Lou was surprised to get the throw from the outfield. But here comes Socha, and you could tell right away, as soon as that out call was made, that they had a great look at it from the Angel dugout.
And he's going to get back in the dugout now, and everybody's going to tell him how bad a call that really was.
Yeah, that's almost like it was an afterthought by Darryl Cousins to make that out call at the third base. So that's a big help
two,
there for the Red Sox.
The second baseman, Adam Kennedy.
And what makes it even, you know, here he comes again because now somebody just told him.
Yeah, somebody told him why they saw the replay.
And now home plate umpire Alfonso Marquez will get in with it. He may be asking for some help at this point, but it's not my call.
Well, if he did see the play and if he saw it better than the second base umpire, he can overrule him.
But after this much time, it would be very difficult. But you might be right, Jerry. I mean, Darryl Cousins may not have been looking at the play at all.
It looked like he was surprised that there was a play over there. The third base umpire was heading out toward the outfield to check on a catch, and Cousins was hanging around in the middle of the infield in his position, and he was slow to turn around, it looked like, to make the call. He did not make the correct call, that's for sure.
And I don't know if we had a camera angle on it or not, but when Darryl Cousins put the fist up to be an out sign, it was very hesitant. Oh, big break for the Red Sox. If you're scoring at home, that will go as a fielder's choice, as a matter of fact. An RBI for Benji Molina.
And in a 4-5 put out, right?
And a 4-5 put out. On the play, the Angels did tie the game up as Mo Vaughn scored. Little excuse me, little ground ball to Lou Maloney, who steps on the bag for the final out of the inning. So Red Sox avoid further trouble, and all things considered, not too bad, giving up just the two runs. We're all tied up 2-2 here on Nesson.
A real keg up here in the booth.
I'm impressed. I wonder why Bob Kretz always looks so happy. The studio guys, we get nothing. Hope Tom Karen's having fun down there. Tim Salmon, the right fielder, is up, followed by Garrett Anderson and Troy Gloss. Pitching 91 miles an hour. Rojo has pitched well so far, two runs on four hits. Misses outside. It's 3-1. Arojo has won his last two starts, really, with the exception of the start against Kansas City. He has pitched very well in a Red Sox uniform. Even that first game, which he gave up the grand slam, he was pitching well. If he doesn't have those few walks, really pitched well for the Red Sox so far. One catches the corner. It's 3-2.
Yeah, he had that one bad inning in Oakland where he walked the bases loaded and then gave up the grand slam home run, but after that he was fine. Shaky outing the next time, and then back-to-back very good outings.
And that grand slam he gave up in Oakland came with two outs, so. And of all the ifs and buts you want, right at Nomar, and he has it.
A little different look by Arojo that time, more over the top with the fastball, tried to run it inside on Salmon hit it well, but right at Garcia Parra for the out. More of a four-seam fastball that time instead of the sinker.
The center fielder,
Garcia Parra, takes the hit away from Salmon.
And that brings up Garrett Anderson, who's 0 for 2 tonight. Swings at the first pitch. Arojo makes a nice play. See the play by Arojo.
Very athletic play by Arojo as he'll reach over and make a nice throw to Daubach to get the out. Both pitches. Really good in this game tonight. Getting ahead of hitters, throwing strikes.
And here's Troy Gloss, who was 0 for 1. He walked his last time up. And he was retired on that crazy play at third base. Makes the pitch for a strike. I saw the highlights from the Yankees. I'll tell you what, Jerry, the Rangers can't be too happy having to play a day game today after playing a night game last night here at Fenway.
Now, that had to be probably about a 2:30, 3 o'clock arrival at the hotel, I would guess. That's if everything went well. And then probably about a 10 o'clock bus for a 1 o'clock game. So quick night for the Texas Rangers, but they have a night off in New York tonight. I'm not sure that's a good
right.
thing.
So in other words, they'll be dead again on Tuesday.
Could be.
That's a crazy schedule, considering the fact, you know, first looking at it, you're not knowing the schedule, you say perhaps it's a makeup game. They're just in the city for one day, play the game and get out. But it's the beginning of a series for them. So. And of course, that game that was a night game last night was added fairly recently as a night game. It was originally scheduled as an afternoon game here at Fenway. 1-2 just misses. Two balls, two strikes, two outs. And the 75th pitch of the night misses. It's a full count. The Troy Gloss, Benji Molina waits on deck. There it is, the 3-2 pitch. Outside, ball four. Veritek tried to steal it.
Now you see Rojo trying to stay away from the power hitters. You've got to work him inside to keep him honest, but a lot of breaking balls, fastballs outside. That little slider just off the outside edge. If for this contact by Gloss, he's going to have to hit that ball out to the opposite field. Not an easy thing to do here at Fenway.
Tough pitch to lay off of as well with two strikes. There's Benji Molina. Last time up, he hit that short fly ball in the center that Red Sox got the force play at third.
Gloss can run. He's got 14 steals on the season, but he has been caught seven times.
Yeah, the more you look at Gloss, Jerry, he has impressive numbers. He has the power. He has some speed.
And if he could cut down on the strikeouts a little bit, his average would be higher.
That's something you probably expect will happen as he gets more big league experience, too.
Could be. You never know. I mean, you got guys like Mo that have been striking out the big numbers their whole career, and then they continue to hit a lot of home runs. He may be just one of those hitters.
Molina takes a healthy whack. I'm trying to think of the third baseman around the American League. Who started at third at the All-Star game? Was it Travis Fryman, I think, got the start because of the injury? Paul Carroll will tell us. Third base is a pretty light position right now around the American League.
Now, Ripken got voted in, but he didn't play because of the injury. And then, let's see, you got Brocious with New York. How about the Batista, Tony Batista, up in Toronto?
He's certainly one of the game's bright stars, no question. Was it Fryman that started? I think it may have been.
I have no idea.
Yeah, it was Fryman that started, and Gloss came in relief. But
I can't remember last night at this time.
That's because you had the night off. Second hit batter of the game. First one bounced in the dirt. That one right up and inside on Benji Molina.
That's the last thing he wanted to do there. He wanted to get Molina out, obviously, because you got the left-handed Kennedy coming to the plate. And that'll bring Kerrigan out of that Red Sox dugout.
.16 this season.
That's why that fastball moves so much, and when he throws inside against those righties, he'll get a lot of guys off the shoulder and the arm because of the movement on the fastball. .16 combined between the Red Sox and Colorado.
Number two,
Pedro, I believe, leads the American League. Pedro has plucked 13.
Not a bad thing. The opposing hitters know that as they step into the batter's box against Pedro, that he'll hit you once in a while. It's a little more difficult to hit, and that one is rocked to deep right center. Darren Lewis gives it a run, back to the wall, and that ball is gone! Three-run home run by Adam Kennedy, and the Angels take a 5-2 lead.
Well, we talked about all the home runs in the open, but we didn't feature Adam Kennedy in that list. He hits his eighth of the season. Now, remember, early in the game, back in the third, he hit a ball very well off of Rojo to right field. This time, a little bit deeper and into that Red Sox bullpen for the three-run home run.
And the hit batter does indeed hurt a Rojo. He retired the first two batters of the inning. And then walk Gloss, hit Molina.
Yeah, that pitch to Gloss just missed outside. And then, of course, hitting Molina. That was the... That's the thing he didn't want to do in this inning.
And here's Ron Gant, who doubled his last time up. Struck out looking his first time. The line and right and back into the seats, and that home run has quieted this Fenway crowd.
Sure, there'll be some rookie of the year votes for that player at second base. Adam Kennedy, he's had a nice season.
Swing and a miss, he got him. And that will retire the side, but the Angels do some heavy damage on the three-run home run by Adam Kennedy. And the Angels have grabbed a 5-2 lead here at Fenway. Welcome back to Fenway. The Red Sox now staring at a three-run deficit, 5-2, as Adam Kennedy belts a two-out, three-run home run for the Angels to give him a lead. But a big day for the Red Sox as they sign one of their early draft picks, the first pick of the second round. Manny Del Carmen, must be a big thrill here signing with a hometown team.
Well, it's my dream to play with them someday, so now I got a shot at it, and I got to make the best of it.
And sign today, and you'll be playing baseball in a couple of weeks.
Yep, hopefully.
Where do you go? How does it work?
Well, I have to be at Fort Myers, Florida, September 10th. So I'll leave Boston like September 4th. So give me a good time to work out and stuff before the season starts.
The Red Sox have a history of bringing some local guys in. Lou Maloney, you see how the Red Sox fans treat him. It would obviously be a big thrill out of West Roxbury High School to be out here and pitching in Fenway. It must be something you've been dreaming about for a long time.
Well, family and friends wish me the best. So I'm going to do it for my mom and dad and the Spanish community of Boston.
You were the first graduate of the Red Sox RBI program. Well, tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I've been revolved like around the Red Sox since I was little. Played Red Sox Rookie League, RBI League. So basically, the Red Sox was my dream. So now I know what to do.
Carl Everett down in the count 1-2, and it hit him. The Red Sox get a base runner. See if they can turn this into something here in the bottom of the sixth. Down by three runs. He had a great high school career. I know that you beat Bridgewater Raynham earlier this season, struck out 16. That's always good when you do that to the Trojans. No offense to the folks from Bridgewater Raynham, but 20 strikeout game as well in there. So what was your highlight of your high school career?
Well, it was a 20 strikeout game, like you said, and it was a no-hitter, so I think that was my best game this year in the regular season.
How about the day you found out the Red Sox drafted you?
I wasn't even home to get the news, but when I got home, I was one happy kid.
Here's Nomar. He's intentionally walked his last time up.
Who'd you pitch a no-hitter against?
O'Brien High School.
I'm going to talk about some numbers, Jerry. 7-1 with a 0.40 ERA.
Who beat you?
Andover.
Andover? You let them beat you?
Yep.
Oh, there's something like 1-0 or something?
Yeah. No, they beat us 4-3. But it was opening game of the season, so it was still kind of cold, but
Oh, lost your first decision and then undefeated the rest of the way.
Yep.
And of course, all the stories in the newspapers about the tournament time, from a coach's perspective, do you pitch your number one pitcher early in the tournament, or do you hold him out a little bit? And I know you only get one shot at that when you're a senior in high school, but you understood the strategy, obviously.
Well, I thought if we hit, we can win. But things happen in baseball, so that day wasn't our day. Nobody hit the ball as usual. So can't blame it on bad coaching. It's just team didn't do what they had to do.
What do you expect the biggest challenge for you to be going from high school into professional baseball?
Well, I know it's going to be hard, but my dad's been through it. He went with the Phillies organization in his time. So he told me how hard it's going to be, and I know I got to work hard and get out of the minor leagues as soon as possible. So I got to make my mother proud, and hopefully she'll see me pitching there one day.
Well, you already got a 20-strikeout game. Clemens had a couple of 20-strikeout games. All you need is one more.
How many innings was that game? Well, usually high
seven.
School,
seven
usually innings. High school games are seven innings, Jerry. Seven innings. 20 strikeouts. Some leagues do play nine innings in Massachusetts, but most play seven.
Yeah.
Red Sox have something going here as Nomar draws the walk. Well, you must have been on fire that day.
I was feeling good. There's a couple of, like, good 22 scouts there, so I had to put on a show.
That's going to be a little intimidating, isn't it, to look behind home plate and see all those people watching it?
Well, my dad tells me to act like they're not even there, so he just told me to go pitch my game, so that's what I do.
You do see him, though.
Yeah. One of them guns at you, so can you do?
You have all your teammates. You're letting them, giving them some exposure. Anybody else get drafted?
Not that I know.
That's what you feel bad for, all the teammates. They have to get up with 20 scouts there watching them hit. Were you exclusively a pitcher, or did you play other positions too?
I played a short for school if I didn't pitch. So my dad was a shortstop, so I played a little bit of short. But my career's basically been around pitching.
How about all your buddies now? You must be the must have been the big man on campus as school was ending and getting drafted by the Red Sox. It's one thing to be drafted into the majors, that's good enough, but drafted by the Red Sox, that's even more special.
Well, my friends, they're very happy for me, so I want to make it for the Spanish community, all my friends, my family members, so I'm ready.
Well, good luck to you, and take care of your parents when you start making some money. You're already making some, but when you make the big stuff, take care of your parents.
All right.
Manny, thanks a lot for joining us.
Thank you.
Manny Del Carmen, second-round draft pick for the Red Sox. Watching a good ball game here at Fenway, and the Red Sox have something working with two on and nobody out. Troy O'Leary, the batter. Bernard Gilkey waits on deck. Carl Everett was hit by a pitch on a 1-2 count, and Nomar draws the walk. Scott Schoenweiss in his second inning of trouble now for the Angels. And O'Leary goes back up the middle. Everett is being waved in. He will score. Nomar stops at second, and it's a 5-3 game. So Troy O'Leary, who didn't look very good his first couple times up against Schoenweiss, delivers here.
Well, the first two at-bats, he tried to keep the ball away from him. This time he tries to go inside, and O'Leary's ready for that fastball on the inside part of the plate. Shoot the line drive up the middle and get the Red Sox back within two. A hit batter, a walk, and base hit, and that's going to start some activity out in the bullpen for the Angels.
And here comes pitching coach Bud Black. Scored three runs in the top of this inning. A 2-out, three-run home run by Adam Kennedy. Now the Red Sox have one run home and still nobody out with two runners aboard.
busy in the truck making those t-shirts all afternoon.
What does it say? The Red Sox rock our world.
Number 28, the designated hitter, Bernard Gilkey.
Petkazic and Holtz loosening for the Angels.
Bernard Gilkey is 0 for 2 tonight. Grounded out to third twice. Gilkey with a modest 5-game hitting streak. I'd like to make it 6 straight right here. Fouled back, it's 1-1. That was the 85th pitch of the night for Schoenweiss. It's interesting, he retired the side in order in the first and second, and in the fourth, and in the fifth. The Sox scored 2 runs in the third. They have 1 run home here in the sixth. So it's a case of all or nothing. 2-1. Into left field, and not falling fast enough as Palmeiro comes in to stab it. Look for a second, that ball may get down, but had enough air under it for Orlando Palmeiro to come in and grab it.
Here at Fenway Park, it's always wise as a left fielder to play shallow. We see so many left fielders come in here and play deep with their back against the wall, but Palmeiro doing the right thing. He's playing shallow, and he's able to take the base hit away from Gilkey.
A ball that may drop in a lot of other ballparks.
Yeah, they can't be that honest in other ballparks. They've got to be a little bit deeper, but not here at Fenway Park.
And that will bring up Jason Varite. He's 1 for 2 tonight. His base hit started the damage in the third. And the Red Sox have some action in their bullpen as well as Real Cormier begins to warm up. Misses inside. Nomar Garciaparra, the runner at second. Troy O'Leary is at first. One out. We're in the bottom of the sixth. The Red Sox down 5-3. Schoenweiss with the 1-0 pitch back up the middle. Bobbled by Adam Kennedy, but still has time to turn it into 2. So the Red Sox get just the 1 run, and they squander an opportunity. It's 5-3 after 6. Down by 2 as we go to the ninth inning, and a new pitcher on the hill for the Red Sox, Derek Lowe.
Last time out for Lowe, he picked up a save. That was against Texas. And that was back on the 18th. Lowe has not allowed an earned run in his last 13 innings of work at the covering 9 games. And it's one of those, hold him right there, we'll get you a couple of runs in the ninth.
Ron Gant, the number 9 batter, the first one to face Derek Lowe. Swings at the first pitch. And we'll give the fans a souvenir back on the street. Gant has a double tonight. Sandwiched around a couple of strikeouts. Tigers up 3-1 in the eighth inning on Oakland. If that score should hold true, regardless of what happens here at Fenway, the most the Red Sox will be back in the wild card race is 1 game.
But the Angels would be 1 game closer to the Red Sox.
True. That is a log jam, to be sure. As a matter of fact, the folks in Detroit are saying they're still in this race as well. They're like 6 games back. Looking at a short right, Darren Lewis is there.
I'll tell you what, that Detroit story is one of the best stories of the year. I mean, this team started out, they couldn't win a game. And all of a sudden, they're very close to being a 500 team. That's amazing comeback, and you got to credit Phil Garner, you know, for not allowing those guys to quit.
Orlando Palmeiro.
They're like two games under 500 at 60 and 62 coming into play tonight. I think that puts them like six games back.
I mean, at the beginning of the year, they didn't look like they were going to win 20 games all season long the way they were playing.
And you're right, Jerry. That's a credit to the manager. You think he's finally been able to put his style into play. This wild card race will be interesting to watch as we go into September. There's so many teams still alive. The Red Sox don't play the Blue Jays again. They do have Oakland again. I think two games against the Athletics. Chop to second. Offerman has it. They have quite a few games against Cleveland.
Yeah, they got a tough schedule coming up in the month of September. You got four at the Yankees, three here, one at the stadium, a makeup game. You get all those doubleheaders. Doubleheader with Detroit, who's playing good baseball. You got the back-to-back day-night doubleheaders, which
Kevin Stocker.
I can't imagine what that's going to be like. So it's not going to be easy.
Here's Kevin Stocker. I guess the good news about all those doubleheaders, at least the Red Sox will be able to call up some pitching from Pawtucket as the rosters expand. Tries to bunt his way on. This could be a tough play for Jose Offerman, and he makes the nice play. An outstanding play by Jose Offerman as he grabs it with his bare hand and in one motion makes the throw to first base, and he may have hurt himself. And flexing that wrist just a little bit, but a great play by Jose Offerman to put the Angels down in the ninth. We go to the home half. The Red Sox chasing two. Last call for the Red Sox here at Fenway. They're down by two in the home half of the ninth. And the lefty, the starter, Scott Schoenweiss, still on the hill looking for his second complete game of the year. Went the distance against Toronto back on April 10th. First pitch to Troy O'Leary is in there for a strike. O'Leary had a base hit his last time up, went back up the middle with it. Scored a run. Chops it to second. Kennedy has it. And quickly, 1-0. Couple of plays at the plate for the Red Sox. The defense coming through as Brian Daboch back in the fifth inning. Makes the steady play, gets the out on Ron Gant. And in the eighth inning, the double play as Carl Everett delivers one to Jason Varitek to get the out. But right now, the story is the Red Sox offense. They need some. Down by two.
That assist for Everett was number 10 on the season. Bobby Higginson leads the American League with 14. Salmon has 11. And then it's Everett and Dave Martinez with 10.
Red Sox have seemingly caught a couple of breaks in this game, but unable to capitalize. Jason Varitek is on deck. Brian Daboch, Darren Lewis to follow if the Red Sox should rally. They see a pinch hitter or two in there as well. The shortstop, Kevin Stocker, backs up on the ball, makes a nice play. The Red Sox are down to their final out. Don't want ESPN News coming up too soon. Still looking for a couple of runs. If Varitek should reach, the tying run would be up in the person of Brian Daboch. Varitek ahead in the count 2-0. Taking it's 3-0. And taking all the way right here.
Go, buddy.
ball four. And that will bring the tying run to the plate in the person of Brian Daba. And Mike Socha has an interesting decision to make right here. Does he keep his starter in, the lefty to face a lefty, or does he bring in his new closer, Shigetoshi Hasegawa?
Well, I would say that if Dalbach's going to be allowed to hit in this situation, he's going to stay with Schoenweiss. Right hand is on the bench, Manny Alexander and Mike Lansing. Lansing's been struggling some recently. And Dalbach has one hit in this ballgame tonight. Pushing the outfield back, nothing over their head. They're not concerned about the man at first, but they are concerned about the man at the plate. They don't want him standing on second base.
Hasegawa has really emerged as quite a story for the Angels, but they will stick with the lefty. Scott Schoenweiss to face the lefty, Brian Daba, representing the tying run at the plate. Fifth straight ball out of the zone, 1-0. Mike Lansing getting ready to pinch hit. He can find his bat. He would be hitting for Darren Lewis. Outside, ball two. Mike Socha telling Benji Molina to think behind the plate. Let's throw a strike, but don't groove it. The 2-0 pitch. Borderline strike, 2-1. $32,795 hoping for a Red Sox comeback here at Fenway. They're down by two, two outs in the ninth. The 2-1 to Dalbach, lifted in the air, deep to right field. Tim Salmon goes back, back to the wall, and it is gone! A home run for Brian Dalbach, and this game is tied 5-5.
Until two outs here in the ninth inning. Dalbach left to pinch hit to hit against a left-handed pitcher. And into the bullpen, just over the glove of Tim Salmon. He's got a flair for the dramatic, doesn't he?
No question about it. He likes to hit in the late innings. And now, since the Red Sox have come back to tie it up, Mike Lansing will not pinch hit for Darren Lewis. Lewis will get the hit for himself. Schoenweiss fell behind in the count to Brian Dalbach. He sat on one, and boy, he did not miss. When Mike Socha looked to Benji Molina and said, think, I don't think he was thinking about that.
Well, you know, you go back and you look at the ball game, and he has that great control all night long. He ends up walking Veritek with two outs to give Dalbach the chance. Dalbach with his 17th home run of the season.
Schoenweiss retired the first two batters of the inning, then issued the walk to Jason Veritek with two outs, one out away from the complete game victory. And then Brian Dalbach ties it up, and that will be the end of the night for the lefty, who pitched very well and right now has to be saying to himself, what happened? Departs. And there you see it, 8 of the last 12 home runs the Red Sox have hit have either tied the score or given the Red Sox the lead. It was the third home run for Daboc against the lefty this season.
And the next pitch will be Mark Pekhizik. They had Hashigawa, but once the score was tied, they went back to Pekhizik, who'd been loosening up two or three times during this ball game. This will be his 50th appearance overall. And Schoenwein still can't believe what happened to him. Two out in the ninth, a walk, and then the home run to the left-hander hitting Daboc.
And Jimmy Williams will go to the bench for a pinch hitter. It'll be Trot Nixon, the lefty, to hit against the right-hander. Third ball in there for a strike. Takes that one outside for a ball. It's one and one. A little unsure, couldn't check the swing. It's one and two. Nixon is 1 for 7 this season as a pinch hitter with a couple of walks. I'd like to make it 2 for 8. The 1-2, check swing. Molina wants to know if he went. He did not go. And it's 2-2. Jerry, this game is not won yet, certainly. It's tied up 5-5, but you had a feeling with all the breaks the Red Sox were getting that something good would happen.
Well, he waited a long time for that something good to happen.
The 2-2. Swung on a missed. He struck him out. But the Red Sox tie it up on the two-run home run by Brian Daboc. And we will play a little extra tonight here at Fenway. We go to the 10th, tied up at 5. And back at Fenway, all tied up, 5-5, extra innings between the Red Sox and the Anaheim Angels. Game one of this three-game series. Very big series for both clubs.
Now heading for Anaheim, number 25, the third baseman, Troy.
And a dangerous hitter at the plate for the Angels, Troy Gloss. 36 home runs. He's 0 for 1 tonight with 3 walks. And Derek Lowe into his third inning of work. He has gone 3 innings twice this season. Last time, August 1st, against the Seattle Mariners. Troy Gloss, Benji Molina, and Adam Kennedy. Behind in the count to this guy, it's 3-1. Down the line, and that's a fair ball. Gloss hitting first on his way to second, and he is in there with a double.
Well, they had the prevent defense on. They had Maloney tight on that line in case of a ground ball down the line. So instead, Troy Gloss will get that fastball and put it on a line up over Maloney's head and all the way down in that left field corner for the leadoff double. So we'll see how Mike Socia plays this now with Molina coming to the plate and a left-hander on deck and Kennedy, see if he bunts him over.
See what the Red Sox are looking to do defensively here. Molina 0 for 3 tonight. He was hit by a pitch. Scored a run back in the sixth. He is bunted. Bunts it hard to Lou Maloney, who has the play. And moving to third is Troy Gloss.
Good bunt there by Molina. Bunted it hard enough where he had to pull Maloney off the bag to make the play. That left third base wide open. The runner will just cruise into third base. And, of course, Molina rounded first. Maloney kind of hanging around that bag. If it's not that hard, then the pitcher has a chance to get it, and they have a play at third. But with the bunt going hard, Maloney has to come off the bag, and a good job done by Molina. Red Sox pull the infield in.
Molina to Maloney.
Always have to be aware in these situations, obviously, of the squeeze play.
A little less likely, perhaps, with a left-handed hitter?
Not really.
Infield in. Kennedy with a long look. Down to Renicki at third base. Who had a long look into the dugout. A little chat now with Gloss. Here he comes. Here's the squeeze, and it's going. Called it, Jerry.
Get yourself an account where you know they're going to throw a strike. Unlikely to pitch out in that situation. 1-0 that gets the fastball and a nice job done. All you got to do with the squeeze play is get the ball on the ground. It doesn't matter where it goes. Just get it on the ground. Don't leave too soon. Good job by the Angels to execute. The leadoff double, the sacrifice to advance the man, and then the squeeze play for the go-ahead run.
Taking a lot of time to get into the batter's box is Ron Gant. Thought it may be perhaps that they wanted to get Shigetoshi Hasegawa warmed up in the bullpen, but no action out there. And now there's some scrambling. Hasegawa does begin to warm up. And if you're looking at the Red Sox, half of the 11th inning, Nomar Garciaparra, Troy O'Leary, and Bernard Gilkey.
That's the first run allowed by the Red Sox bullpen. Cormier, Garces, and Coslow now being into the third inning.
Check swing. Low has it. And he gets Ron Gant. But the Anaheim Angels have snapped this 5-5 tie on the squeeze play. And they have a 6-5 lead as we go to the home half of the 11th. Red Sox will have to play a little comeback baseball once again. They're down by a run here in the 11th inning. 6-5. And Mark Isaac still out there for the Angels as Hasegawa continues to warm. This could be the same scenario, Jerry, that Jimmy Williams pulled a little earlier in the game.
I don't know. I'm watching Socha in that dugout, and maybe he's going to give Pick Isaac one base runner if it comes to that.
And Hasegawa looks like he's ready. And no movement out of the Angels' dugout, so Nomar Garciaparra will hit against Bekaiser. Perhaps Omar has a problem with him. Breaking ball in there for a strike. Omar hitless tonight in a couple of official at-bats. He does have two walks.
He's 0-for-5 in his career against Bekaiser. Plus, it'd be Troy Percival if he was healthy, but obviously he's on the disabled list. Percival had 25 saves before going down.
Hasegawa has really emerged out of that bullpen. He has not allowed a run to score in 23 consecutive innings. That's the second longest streak among relievers in the majors this season. He hasn't given up an earned run in his last 30 innings. Down low, ball three, 3-1. Good count to hit, and that's low, ball four, and the Red Sox have a tying run aboard. So Socha lets him pitch to Nomar, but he won't let him pitch to Troy O'Leary.
Well, let's see if he goes for the right-hander or the left-hander. He's also got a lefty Holtz out there with O'Leary coming to plate. If he brings in the lefty, O'Leary will probably be bunting. If he brings in the righty, he may be swinging away. Be the lefty Holtz.
So Mike Holtz gets the call as Mark Kaizic walks Nomar Garciaparra to start the bottom of the 11th for the Red Sox. Down by two, two outs, and he delivers in a very big way. High and deep and gone to right field. The game tying two out, two run home run. And that is why we are still playing. But in the top of the 11th inning, the Angels squeezed home a run on the suicide squeeze to make it 6-5. And now Mike Holtz is the pitcher.
48th appearance. He's got 36 strikeouts in 32 and two-thirds innings. Holtz, opponent's hitting 254 against him. 1-2. He worked in the game yesterday against the Yankees. An inning, a hit, earned run, a home run allowed, and a couple of strikeouts for Holtz. Always pretty tough on those lefties. Good breaking ball.
Now we'll see how Jimmy Williams wants to play this one. And Troy O'Leary is not sure, so he wants to talk to Wendell Kim. Have that squared away. Earl Leary doesn't see the bunt sign very often.
He had a hit also earlier against Schoenweiss, the left-hander. Base hit to drive in a run back in the sixth inning.
Probably a quick toss to first base to see if Earl Leary gives anything away.
He already gave it away.
He does. July 10th, 1997.
We'll see if they switch off with the count going 1-0, where he may get a fastball.
Squaring early again. Pulls back. It's in there for a strike, 1-1, and now Wendell Kim wants to have a talk.
Yeah, I think that Troy seems to be having some problems here. He may have had the swing on that 1-0 count, and instead he squared around a bunt. Now he's going to talk to Kim again and make sure he's got this thing straight.
Well, Jimmy didn't look happy right there. A lot of movement in the Angels infield.
Finally,
it took a while, but finally, Mike Socha will give the ball to his new closer.
Look at Tashi Hashigawa on to trying to close this thing out, although he's got his work cut out for him here. First and third and nobody out. Six saves since taking over for Troy Percival in this role, a record of 8-2. Pretty good split-fingered fastball, which, of course, is a ground ball pitch, and I think that's something maybe he'd like right now. The first and third, you know, you might want to, you're tying it maybe okay, but they like to wipe out a couple of those base runners. Atterberg's going to pinch hit for Gilkey, which would tell you that there's not going to be a sacrifice here. He'll be swinging away, and then you have Veritek and Dorbach to follow.
As a matter of fact, the right-hander will be facing five lefties in a row, since Jose Offerman's a switch hitter and can turn around to bat from the left side as well.
Now Sagawa, so far this year against the Red Sox, he's pitched a total of 2 1/3 innings, one strikeout and one save against Boston.
Masagawa has stepped right in for the Angels. Talking to their play-by-play announcer before the game, Steve Fisiak, and he said that this guy is just nails. He's very steady. Nothing gets to him on the mound. This situation is not likely to get him rattled at all. And growing up in Japan, Steve was expecting some big answer when he asked him what made him so courageous. You know what he said? I used to get beat up in seventh grade.
Number 10, Scott Hatterberg.
Here's Scott Hatterberg. Pinch hitting for Bernard Gilkey. Tying run is on third. Nomar Garciaparra.
Infield in, excuse me, Bob, not all the way, though. They have a tough choice to make. If that runner takes off, which he should on the ground ball, they're going to have to come to the plate if it's right at him.
So here we go. Scott Hatterberg takes the first pitch low. Troy O'Leary is the runner at first base.
As the runner at third, you have to go on a ground ball with nobody out. You don't want a double play. If it's a ground ball where there's not going to be a double play, then maybe you stay home. That's also a tough call for that runner at third.
In there for a strike. It's 1-1. Should this game go to the 12th, Rod Beck is warming up in the Red Sox bullpen. But first things first, the Red Sox are down by a run. They need to tie it first, and they'd like to win it here. High ball two, 2-1. Jason Veritek is in the on-deck circle. Outside ball three, 3-1. The 3-1 is still five. Over the roof box seats in left field. And it's a full count.
Hendricks had a couple of pitches to work on, and this at bat, he took one right down the middle for a strike, and that pitch was up in the zone a bit. Fouls it off.
Troy O'Leary is the runner at first base. Not a lot of speed. But it is a full count. 3-2. Nobody out. Victor Lugo. For the home to first double play, Manny Alexander will run for Scott Hatterberg.
Ladies and gentlemen, your attention please. For the Red Sox, now running for Hatterberg at first base, number 29, Manny Alexander. Alexander now running for Hatterberg.
So here we go, the base is loaded, nobody out for the Red Sox. Garcia Parra, the runner at third, O'Leary at second. Manny Alexander takes his lead at first base. And with the infield playing in, O'Leary can get a very big lead at second base, making it much easier to score the game-winning run on a base hit.
Yeah, the only thing you have to watch out for is that line drive right at the shortstop, and he can just turn around and tag you. Clear yourself for the shortstop.
Outside, one and one. Ryan Dalloff, who is the hero so far tonight, is on deck. Dalloff with the two-out, two-run home run in the ninth to tie it up. He doesn't want to hit right here. Jason Veritek can end it with a base hit. It's one and two.
Is that splitter from Hasegawa? Tough pitch to lay off. You see it as a strike and the bottom falls out.
Hasegawa in a jam here with the bases loaded and nobody out. The 1-2 pitch. Fights it off.
Good job there by Veritek. You got to be thinking after that the last splitter that maybe he'd come back with another one. He tried to sneak the fastball by him, and he's just able to get a piece of it to foul it off.
Garcia Parra represents the tying run at third. O'Leary, the game-winning run at second. There it is, the 1-2 is low. It's 2-2. Second base. Oh no, Manny Alexander didn't know. Very close play at third. Manny Alexander didn't run enough on that play from first base. Could have been a triple play.
Now that's a heck of a play by Molina, the catcher. First of all, Kennedy right here is going to take the ground ball and go home with it. Now, for some reason, Alexander's going back to the bag. I have no idea why. There's the double play at first base. And if Mo looked toward second, they might have had Alexander. Instead, he makes the throw to third base. And that ball almost got by the third baseman.
Yeah, strange play. The Angels get the double play.
Wow, there have been some unbelievable plays in this game tonight. And talk about a hush coming over Fenway.
Bizarre play. Adam Kennedy starts the double play, throws home, good strong throw.
See, that's a good job by Molina here as he cleared himself with that runner to make sure that he made a good throw. And then for some reason, Mo decided to go across the diamond. Really had no play there on O'Leary, but he certainly had a play on Alexander.
I don't know why that play was. was even as close as it was. With the bases loaded on the ground, you got to be running.
Well, let's see what they got here. They got first base open. Dornbach, who has already hurt him tonight, with Nixon on deck. Looks like they're going to go after Dornbach.
So the Red Sox had the bases loaded and nobody out. Now they have runners on second and third and two outs. You might say, just give them one splitter after another. First base is open. Trot Nixon is on deck.
That was the danger with the splitter, too, that it'll bounce. And they get by the catcher.
With a chance to be a hero again here at Fenway. That's your tying run, that's your winning run. Side ball two, 2-1. As this homestand continues with dramatics night after night. Hello. And the hero of the ball game, Brian Dalbach, joining us down on the field. And Brian, this is the way the homestand has gone. You guys keep fighting to the final out. And again tonight, you were a hero twice.
Yeah, it's been somebody different every night, this homestand. And, you know, we can't expect Nomar and Carl to pick us up every night. And it's been a couple different guys in this homestand. Hopefully, just keep it going.
Brian, when you went in the ninth inning and they had the lefty out there, were you kind of looking over your shoulder a little bit, like maybe they're going to pinch it?
I mean, he was a starting pitcher, so I faced him three times. I had a couple good at-bats against him. Jimmy gave me a shot and tied it up. You know, I haven't had a whole lot of hits lately, but there's been some big ones in the ninth.
Your final hit of the night was not as powerful as the one of the ninth, but it works just the same. Scores two. You dropped it in there, and like I said, a hero twice tonight.
That's more luck than last thing than anything, but you know, it's a big hit for us. With Oakland losing, we're back where we want to be.
And like we said, this homestand has worked out with one come from behind victory after another. You guys starting to feel like no matter how many runs you guys are down, you can fight back.
That's where we've been the last couple of years, and you know, we haven't always come back, but at least we battled 9 innings, and it's a good way to start the Bob Rogers era.
Thanks, Brian.